Good morning and welcome to our service this morning. I just have a couple of intimations, and the first is for our Kirk session. Our Kirk session meeting is on Wednesday evening this week. That is once again on Zoom, so Wednesday 10th of November at 7:30 p.m. And next Sunday is Remembrance Sunday. And next week we're going to start our service 15 minutes early so that we can share with everyone else around the country in the national 2-minute silence at 11 o'clock. So 10:45 start for next Sunday's service. As we prepare for our worship this morning, let us turn to today's thought for prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for this wonderful world created by you and given to us to cherish and sustain its well-being. We rejoice in the rising of the sun each morning, bringing light and life to the earth and all its inhabitants. We give thanks for the moon and the stars that continue to shine as they penetrate the darkness through the night. Autumn and winter and spring and summer revolve like clockwork, but now the imbalance of climate change has threatened our survival on Earth. Our prayers today cry out for those who are already suffering. Our earnest hope is that each one of us will hear the wake-up call to act responsively and positively. God, our Maker, you have blessed us so much. Renew our hearts to work for the good of all creation. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to our worship in St. Mary's this morning. Whether you are here in person or joining us later in the week online, may you know God's peace and love with you and for you today. We gather in this place believing that God made us and loves the world. We come to sing, to honour the God who gave us voice, to pray together that the earth may be restored to reflect God's glory, and to worship the living God, maker of heaven and earth. Let us do that right now in our opening praise, standing to sing together 212, Morning Has Broken. Thank you. Well, good morning, boys and girls. It's lovely to see you today. In the vestry, I could not believe my eyes when I came in this week and realised that 2 weeks on, the balloons that we used for harvest are still up. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Yep, they're still going strong. And I brought them back out today because just as a fortnight ago we were thinking about harvest and thanking God for all the wonders of creation, so today we're going to be thinking about creation once again. And I don't know about anybody else, but yesterday about 3:30, there was the most beautiful rainbow filled the sky. Did you see it? Did you see a rainbow yesterday? Yeah. Did anybody else see the rainbow yesterday? Some nods of the head, yep. And it was wonderful because when you looked at some of the pictures from Glasgow yesterday and the folks marching at COP26, there was beautiful rainbows in Glasgow and those pictures too. So that was lovely to see. And it's creation that we're going to be thinking about today. And there's lots of different ideas about creation and how it started. But today in church, we're going to be going back to the very first book of the Bible called Genesis. Way back to chapter 1, and we're going to be thinking about the very first story of creation that we find there. We have got two, but we're going to be thinking of the first one. And to help us think about that, I want you to imagine that this here is creation. This is planet Earth, our home. I know it's a bit of a stretch, but this is what it is. And I want us to think about what God did right at the beginning, because right at the beginning, we're told in the Bible that there was nothing. Everything, it was completely empty. And then God decided that he was going to make some wonderful things. And he separated the dry bits and he called them land. And he separated the wet bits and he called them rivers and seas. And then he decided he was going to fill it with wonderful things. Could somebody come and hold planet Earth for me? Have I got a volunteer to do that? You can sit there and do it if you like. Would that be okay? That's great. Thank you. Now, let's have a think about some of these wonderful things that God filled the world with. Can you think of anything? What are you whispering, Elaine? Pandas, absolutely. That's a lovely panda you've got there. Yep, pandas. Anything else? Yeah.
People?
People, absolutely. I've got them. Prepared at breakfast this morning. God made us. Yep, well done. People. Anything else? Grace?
Houses.
Houses. Okay. Why not? Anything else? Living things. I'm going to put down the rainbows as well. What do we find in our gardens? Weeds, yeah, do you know what? Why not? God made the weeds as well. We've got the weeds. And we've got flowers, haven't we? We all enjoy the flowers in our garden. Anything else? Was it just pandas?
Hedgehogs,
thank you. Do you get any pets? Yeah, what have you got? A cat, so God made the cats as well. I see you've got your cat with you as well. Cats and dogs. What about what lives in the water?
Fish.
Yep. There we are. And you know the truth is, yep.
Octopuses,
yes, thank you. Quite a few going there, and the truth is we could go around everyone here in church and we would run out of paper because there's just so many things that God made in our world, from the cats and the dogs, the hedgehogs and the octopuses, everything that lives in the sea, everything that lives in the land, the trees, the plants. God made it all. And God looked at it all and he thought, that looks good. And then you're absolutely right. He looked back and he thought, there's something missing. And God decided to make us human beings. And he stepped back and he looked at everything that he made and he said, that is very good. And then he looked at human beings, the people, and he said, I put you in charge. I give you control to care for and to look after all the plants and all the animals and all the living things on planet Earth. Have we done that well? I'm seeing shakes of the head. No, we haven't, have we? We haven't done such a great job. We've chopped down trees. We've put nasty things in the water. We've polluted the air. Not just us, humanity as a whole. And we've not done a very good job. And we really need to mend our ways before things go beyond repair. That's what we've been thinking about at COP26. Otherwise, well, something pretty catastrophic will happen. And I prepare you now. You might want to cover your ears. If we don't mend our ways and look after this earth, then all the living things, the plants, the animals, they'll be gone. Because our earth is warming up, isn't it? We need to get the temperature under control and down. Otherwise, it's predicted by the end of this century, at least 550 species will be extinct. And that's really sad, isn't it? And is that what God wants? No, I don't think that's what God wants at all. God has given us responsibility to care for planet Earth. And that's what we're going to be thinking about today. And you know, sometimes we might think about climate change and think, oh my goodness, it's so overwhelming. What can we possibly do? And the truth is, it needs every single person in the whole wide world to play our part. But doing nothing isn't an option. And we can think of ways to look after the earth, our home, right where we are. So I think you're going to be thinking about that through in Young Church, and we're going to be thinking about that here too. But for now, let's just bow our heads and have a wee prayer. Lord God, today we give you thanks for this beautiful creation that we call home. We give you thanks for all the living things in it, from the hedgehogs to the octopus to the whale to the trees to the birds that fly in the air, everything. And we remember our call to look after it and to care. Lord, we say we're sorry for the ways in which we haven't done that, and we pray for your help to do that better. For we ask it all in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to sing again. And the hymn is 137, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
Thank you.
during the week. Well, in truth, on Tuesday morning, I stood in the scales and I thought, oh my goodness, I really need to do something about this. And come Wednesday, I got on my trainers and my running stuff and I dropped Grace off at school and I thought, right, I'm going to go. And I put in my headphones and my headphones wouldn't work. No music, but I thought, you know what? I'm just going to go and do it anyway. And it was the best thing I could have done. Because as I ran, I could hear. I could hear the birds singing in the trees. As I ran down a wee passageway that took me along by the river, I could hear the river running by. And I could see, really see and focus on all that was around me. The berries on the tree, God's provision and abundance. And I was just wowed by creation. And I came in and I turned to Lectio 365 that I know some of you have been listening to as well, a daily devotion app. And that morning I was asked this. As I reflect on this teeming world of abundance, its creatures and places, what would I like to say to the Lord of creation? And the words that sprang to mind were, thank you. And then as the week unfolded and I thought about that, I wanted to say, sorry. And then, help. And that really are the three words at the heart of our prayer this morning. Let us pray. God, creator of all that lives and moves and breathes in sky, land, space, and sea, we come to praise you today for the beauty of creation, for the splendor of the seasons, for the symmetry in nature, for the very miracle of life that to us, a people of faith, points to you and reveals your handiwork and imagination, shaping and molding, weaving and knitting, sculpting and drawing, designing and fashioning and calling all things into being, declaring, let it be. You look at the world, God, and you love it. Love it enough to come and slip into flesh. Love it enough to die, to reconcile and heal. Love it enough to rise again, calling your children into the way of new creation to reflect your goodness and serve you in the world. God, creator of all, as code red flashes, so we say sorry for our complicity in creation's peril, for the ways that we have used and abused rather than cared for and respected, for our selfishness and greed and short-term thinking, for our failure to love all that you have made. We hold our hands up, God, and we pray for your mercy and your grace and your help, that we might change our ways, be challenged in our thinking, and be enabled to do what we can to care for the creation that you so love. Open our ears, eyes, hearts, and minds as we turn to your word and remind us again of who you are, what you have done, and what we can do in your power. Let it be, O God, creator of all. Let it be. Amen. Let's listen for God's word.
The story of creation. In the beginning, when God created the universe, the earth was formless and desolate. The raging ocean that covered everything was engulfed in total darkness, and the Spirit of God was moving over the water. Then God commanded, "Let there be light," and light appeared. God was pleased with what he saw. Then he separated the light from the darkness, and he named the light day and the darkness night. Evening passed and morning came. That was the first day. Then God commanded, "Let there be a dome to divide the water and to keep it in two separate places." And it was done. So God made a dome, and it separated the water under it from the water above it. He named the dome sky. Evening passed and morning came. That was the second day. Then God commanded, "Let the water below the sky come together in one place, so that the land will appear." And it was done. He named the land earth, and the water which had come together he named sea. And God was pleased with what he saw. Then he commanded, "Let the earth produce all kinds of plants that bear grain and those that bear fruit." And it was done. So the earth produced all kinds of plants, and God was pleased with what he saw. Evening passed and morning came. That was the third day. Then God commanded, "Let lights appear in the sky to separate day from night, and to show the time when days, years, and religious festivals begin. They will shine in the sky to give light to the earth." And it was done. So God made the two larger lights, the sun to rule over the day and the moon to rule over the night. He also made the stars. He placed a light in the sky to shine on the earth, to rule over the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God was pleased with what he saw. Evening passed and morning came. That was the fourth day. Then God commanded, "Let the water be filled with many kinds of living beings, and let the air be filled with birds." So God created the great sea monsters, all kinds of creatures that live in the water, and all kinds of birds. And God was pleased with what he saw. He blessed them all and told the creatures that live in the water to reproduce and to fill the sea. And he told the birds to increase in number. Evening passed and morning came. That was the fifth day. Then God commanded, "Let the earth produce all kinds of animal life, domestic and wild, large and small." And it was done. So God made them all, and he was pleased with what he saw. Then God said, "And now we will make human beings. They will be like us and resemble us. They will have power over the fish, the birds, and all animals, domestic and wild, large and small." So God created human beings, making them to be like himself. He created them male and female, blessed them and said, "Have many children, so that your descendants will live all over the earth and bring it under their control. I am putting you in charge of the fish, the birds, and all the wild animals. I have provided all kinds of grass and all kinds of fruit for you to eat. But for all the wild animals and for all the birds, I have provided grass and leafy plants for food." And it was done. So God looked at everything he had made, and he was very pleased. Evening passed and morning came. That was the sixth day. And so the whole universe was completed. By the seventh day, God had finished what he had been doing and stopped working. He blessed the seventh day and set it apart as a special day, because by that day he had completed his creation and stopped working. And that is how the universe was created. May God bless to us that reading from his holy word. The next hymn is 155, Imagine a World Without Any Flowers.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. As a minister, it probably won't surprise you to know that I've got quite a few Bibles at home. I've got a Good News Translation and a King James, the New Revised Standard Version and the New Living Translation. I have the Message, the Bible in Scots, and as well as quite a few others. I have this one too, the Green Bible. I bought it when it first came out way back in 2008, and it doesn't disappoint. There's nothing particularly fancy about it. I'm told on the back that it's written on paper from environmentally and socially well-managed forests. But the thing that makes it that wee bit different is that when you read it, all the places that mention God as creator or the creation itself are written in green. And as you flick through, you realize that there are many places where that is so. Over 1,000 verses. And so when I was thinking about this week, I had plenty of verses to choose from. But in the end, amidst all of the choices before me, I decided to go back to the beginning and remember who the cause is and who is center of it all as we think about green things, about creation in the midst of COP26. Have you any of you seen Brian Cox's new series called The Universe, Where Life Begins and Ends? Yep, I've seen some nods of the heads. It's fantastic, isn't it? It really is quite wonderful to think about the science behind the creation of the universe, and to see some of those pictures is just wow. And I enjoy that. But I'm afraid at one point, as Stephen will testify, I got a little bit upset. Because there he is talking about the sun, about the importance of light. And he said words to the effect of, there's no need to make up gods to worship when you've got the sun. Well, I'm afraid for me that was a step too far. A step too far in a conversation that I have a lot of time for. When we read the creation story, do I believe that creation happened in 6 days? No, I hold my hands up. I don't. I think the case for evolution is strong. But when you delve into the truth behind that poetry about who is the cause and the creator of it all, do I believe that God is part of that? Absolutely. Science and faith belong together in conversation. And when you start to have those conversations and you stop even for the very shortest of time and consider the beauty and the intricacy and the design that we see all around us in creation, then it begs the question, doesn't it? Where does it all come from? Who made all of this? It was Meister Eckhart who said, if I spend enough time with the tiniest creature, even a caterpillar, I would never have to prepare a sermon. So full of God is every creature. And so we come to such a well-known text, beautiful poetry, one of two creation accounts right at the beginning of our Bible that reveals to us, people of faith, who the creator of the universe is. God. God who, with a word, called all things into being and looked at it when it was finished and was pleased with what God saw and gave humanity, created in God's own image, a particular purpose, placing us in charge to have power over Some translations say dominion over the fish and the birds and all the animals. There's been lots written about what these words mean, but over recent times it's become increasingly apparent that we human beings have taken charge in ways that damage and exploit the earth to the detriment of all living things, including the neighbours that we reminded ourselves last week we are called to love, rather than in the ways that perhaps God intended. Tending, keeping, protecting, nurturing and safeguarding, living in a manner that helps life flourish. And so we find ourselves living at a crossroads, hearing warnings that it's 1 minute to midnight, that we need a warlike footing to face the climate emergency, and that COP26 is our best last chance. Sobering words, aren't they? Words that should make us sit up and take note, especially when we consider some of the other things that the Bible has to say about God and creation. In the passage that we heard just a couple of weeks ago, we read that after the flood, God set a bow in the sky, a covenant of God's promise and relationship, not just with human beings, but with all living things. A sure sign that God cares for all that God has made. Or take one of the best known verses in the whole of Scripture, John 3:16. We all know it. For God so loved the world, so loved the world that he sent Jesus, his son, into it. When we hear those words, sometimes, if you're like me, then you think God so loved people that he sent Jesus into the world. But the Greek word is cosmos. God loved the cosmos so much that he sent his own dear son into the world to save it. Matter seems to matter to God. So much so that when we turn to the New Testament, to Paul's letters to the people in Colossae, we find a beautiful hymn of praise in chapter 1 that describes who Jesus is and why he came into this world. Paul writes, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself was before all things, and in him all things hold together. And I love the next verse, and I love in particular the way the Message translation puts it. In him all the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms, get properly fixed and fit together in vibrant harmonies, all because of his death, his blood that poured down from the cross. The death of Jesus doesn't just have human consequence, it is cosmic in its scope. That's why I was so disappointed to see a banner outside a church in Glasgow that said this: the world's most urgent need is churches preaching Christ crucified, not climate change. And I was disappointed because it seems to me, from my reading of the Bible anyway, that the two go together. That God deeply loves creation, loves it enough to die and rise again for it, and that our response as human beings and Christians to the climate emergency should therefore reflect God's love and care and passion for it too. And yet, you know, you look through our hymn book, some of our best loved hymns, and you get a different impression. We sing and we understand that somehow we're just passing through creation on our way to somewhere else, namely heaven. And that it doesn't really matter how we treat this earth because we're headed somewhere else anyway. And that, well, you know what? We sing hymns like we did, all things bright and beautiful. God who has made all things well, it's God who will sort it out. God has promised, so we don't have to do a thing. Wrong. Or let's remind ourselves just where this story begins and ends. Here, on earth, when we turn to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, we are given a vision of a new heaven and a new earth. And what a wonderful vision it is. A place where there's no more crying or darkness or pain or suffering or death. Why? Because God has come to dwell on earth with his people. Fully. A new heaven and a new earth right here. And when I think about that, for that to happen, we need this planet, don't we? This earth that groans and waits for longing, for freedom and for renewal and for hope. And that's why our response to climate change matters, because it matters to God. God who made all things and was pleased with what he saw. God who gave us a place and a purpose to safeguard and to care. God in whose image we are made and whose love we are called to reflect. God who sent Jesus into this world to save and renew. As followers of Jesus, you and me, through the waters of baptism, are called to be in the power of the Spirit new creations, disciples who are about the ways of the kingdom, as surely as we pray, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. If that is the will, to see creation flourish and thrive and be healed and renewed, then you and me must make changes, collectively and as individuals, to strive to safeguard the integrity of creation and sustain and renew the life of the earth. But if you're like me, and there are times when that just seems so overwhelming. Times when you might feel paralyzed and powerless. Times when you wonder, well, what difference does it make if I recycle, or if I don't put on the heating, or if I walk instead of taking the car, or if I buy fairly traded, or whatever it is. Do you feel like that at times? When you look at the other nations and think, well, what are they doing as they fill the air with pollution? We as individuals are not called to fix it all, but we are called to play our part. Because it is 1 minute to midnight. We do need a warlike footing. And COP26 does seem to be our best last chance. May we hear those words and heed them. And may we all resolve to play our part for the sake of our neighbours and all living things. Let's make that our prayer now as we stand and sing 238, Lord, bring the day to pass. Let us pray. Creator God, who spoke life into being, who looked at the earth and said it good, who slipped into flesh and walked among us, knowing the value of lilies and sparrows and all living things, who lived and died and rose again to reconcile all things to you, and is here and present, longing to see realized the work of creation made new, we come to thank you, to praise you, and to dedicate our offering and ourselves to you as we pray for your will to be done on earth as in heaven. We pray for leaders and groups meeting at COP26. Praying for ambitious decisions, a commitment to action, and for targets that will keep global warming to 1.5 degrees, making a difference for good sooner rather than later and before it is too late. May the voices of those who march and protest give those in power a sense of urgency, a perception of the necessity, and the wisdom and the will to secure the health and well-being of the world at whatever the cost to a nation's wealth or political advantage. For Lord, we know that the time is now. We read the predictions of 132 million being pushed into extreme poverty by 2030 as a consequence of climate change. We see the pictures and we hear the story of those already in dire need. And so we pray for those already enduring the consequences of injustice and climate change, those living through flood or drought, homes devastated, livestock destroyed, families lost, and those who live in a state of poverty, hunger, and hopelessness. We pray for our fragile ecosystem, for rivers dried up, for forests cut down, for species on the brink of extinction. We pray for governments and for businesses that they would choose greener ways and invest in renewable energies, and that we as consumers would make choices that are better and fairer. And we pray for your church. Grant to us all a vision of a world restored to full health that is worthy of all those yet to be born and worth all the sacrifice and commitment which is ours to offer, so that in all our following we might take seriously our call to safeguard the integrity of creation and seek ways together that sustain and renew the life of the earth. For that is your will, this is our calling. May we waken up and get on with making it so. In Jesus' name, amen. David, as always, thank you for accompanying us in our singing today. Before we sing our final hymn, just a couple of intimations, and that is to say that we're edging ever closer to Advent, Christmas. And I know you don't want to hear that maybe, but it is true. And so to that end, a wee reminder to keep drying your tea bags, saving them, making sure they're completely dry before you pop them in the bag and bring them with you on a Sunday. And many thanks to all those who have already done that. And a wee note just to look out on the website and on Facebook in this coming week, because we're looking for your help to make some origami angels. And a wee video has been produced which will give you a step-by-step guide to help you do that, that you can pause and think, oh, have I folded that the right way? Make some origami angels. As we edge closer to Christmas, then all will become clear. And you can spread the word about that and bring them with you on a Sunday morning to church. But for now, we're going to turn to quite simply a beautiful hymn. And we're not going to sing all of the verses. We're going to sing verses 1 and 4 and 7. So that's the first verse and the last verse, and in between verse 4, 1, 4 and 7 of All Creatures of Our God and King.
Thank you.
And now let us go in peace to enjoy the earth and to care for creation in partnership with God. And the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all this day and remain with you forevermore.